So our goal here is to figure out how to write orbital filling diagrams, which are really just another representation like electron configurations. We want to see where those electrons are around the nucleus of an atom. To learn and remember this, you really need to practice. So I'll do an example of an orbital diagram, and then we can work through several together. Let's do the orbital diagram for sodium, Na. So when we look at sodium on the periodic table, its atomic number is 11. So the atomic number, that's equal to the number of protons. And for neutral elements, that's the same as the electrons. We know that this is neutral. There's no positive or negative sign after it. And all of the elements on the periodic table, they're written as neutral. So we have 11 electrons, and we'll spread those out in our orbital diagram here. You can think of the nucleus as being here, and then we have these energy levels around it. So we have 11 electrons. We'll put 2 in the 1s, and note that when we draw this symbol here, we really mean it's an arrow. Same for this. This is also an arrow, and they're representing that we have two electrons with opposite spins. So we put 2 in the 1s. S orbitals can hold 2. We'll put 2 here in the 2s. So we've used 4. We have 11. We'll spread them out in the 2p. We've used 10. And then the last one we put in the 3s. And this is the orbital filling diagram for sodium. If we wanted to write the electron configuration, we'd have 1s2, 2s with 2 electrons in it, 2p with 6, p holds up to 6, and then 3s has 1. So this is the electron configuration for sodium. You could also write the orbital diagram like this. So both the orbital diagram and the electron configuration, they're just telling us the same information, where those electrons are around the nucleus of an element. If you need help writing electron configurations here, there's a link in the description and at the end of this video. So pause and give this one a try. Chlorine. And remember, we have 17 protons. Since this is neutral, we'll have 17 electrons. S orbitals hold 2. P's can hold up to 6. So we'll start with our 1s. We have 2. Next energy level, 2s, that holds 2. 2p, we always spread them out before we pair them up. We've used 10. We have 7 more. We have our 3s, so we have 5 more. 1, 2, 3, spread them out, 4, 5. And this is the orbital diagram for chlorine. If we wanted to write the electron configuration, that would look like this. And for that orbital diagram in this linear fashion, we'd have... But what if we had the chlorine anion, this negative ion, if this was negative? That wouldn't change the number of protons, but it would change the electrons. So because this is negative, we'd have one more electron. Electrons are negative, and we have an extra one here. So we could put that right here, and that would fill the third energy level. That would make this very stable. That's why chlorine gains one electron when it forms ionic bonds with other elements. Then we need to put our other electron here, and then we could change this to a 6. This would be the electron configuration of the chloride ion, Cl minus. Pause and give this one a try. Write the orbital filling diagram for fluorine. So for fluorine, the atomic number is 9. That means 9 protons. And because it's neutral, 9 electrons. Let's spread them out. 1s2, 2s2. We've used 4. We need 5 more. So we spread them out and then double them up, pair them up. And this is the orbital diagram for fluorine. If we write the electron configuration, we have 1s2, 2s2, 2p5. Pause and rewrite this for the fluoride ion, the fluorine, when it gains an extra electron. So for the fluoride ion, F minus, gained an extra electron, so we'll put that right here. Now the second energy level, that's full. Let's change this to a 6. And this is our electron configuration for the fluoride ion. And this is our orbital diagram. Again, we're just trying to show where the electrons are around the nucleus here. Let's try another one. So for calcium, pause. First, do the orbital diagram, then the electron configuration, and then the orbital diagram in this more linear fashion. So we have 20 total electrons for calcium. This is our orbital diagram, and then we can use this to write the electron configuration. And that's the orbital diagram, electron configuration for calcium. But what if calcium formed an ion? Would it gain or lose electrons? It turns out that calcium is going to lose these two electrons here. And since it's lost electrons, it'll be Ca2+. So we'll get rid of this here. And because calcium lost those two electrons, this energy level here, the third energy level is full. It's got 8 electrons. So that's why calcium forms these 2+ ions. So pause and give iron a try. We have 26 protons, so 26 electrons. Spread them out here. And then when we get to our d orbital, we're going to spread them out. D can hold up to 10, and then double them up. We've used all 26 of our electrons. This is our orbital diagram. If we wrote the electron configuration, it would look like this. When we talk about charges with metals, transition metals, they will be positive. It's a little bit more complicated, though. There's a link in the description to this video that discusses how to write the orbital diagrams for transition metals. So to recap, all we're really trying to do here with these orbital filling diagrams, these electron configurations, we're trying to describe where the electrons are around the nucleus of an atom, as well as the energy levels for these electrons. The key is to look at the atomic number, find the number of electrons, and then spread them out in the orbital diagram. You can start with an electron configuration if that's easier for you, or with the orbital diagram, and then write an electron configuration. This is Dr. B, and thanks for watching.